Hi guys, in this course I'll be talking about ancient Indian history strictly from the NCERTs. This is a little bit about me. I'm Nandini and I did my undergrad in history honours. I've discussed NCERT class 6 and class 12 part 1 because these two talk specifically about ancient Indian history, and I haven't exactly followed the way NCERT talks about history. It's more thematic, and I've spoken a little bit more about chronologically and empire wise, so that is, I find that it's a little bit easier to remember from the CSE point of view, not from having an overarching understanding of the thematic and social changes that were happening, which is how the NCERT deals with it. So I have tried to compile the information from these two books and present them in a way that focuses more on answering prelims questions, okay? And the lesson list is, there's one lesson on prehistoric South Asia, which overlaps a little bit with the Harappan Civilization, but Harappan Civilization has a full lesson all to itself. There's one on Vedic literature, which is not from the NCERTs exactly, but I thought that that is another important topic that is really needed. Otherwise, rest are covered in the NCERTs. Then there are two lessons on early states and societies, in which I talked from all the Magadhan empires up till the Pallavas and Chalukyas. And the last lesson is on Buddhism and Jainism, and I really, really urge you to watch that because that's important from the ancient Indian history point of view and the art and culture point of view. I'd just like to clarify these two terms a little bit. So AD and BC were being used beforehand, talking about the turn of the century. AD stood for Anno Domini and BC stood for before Christ, and that BC is before the birth of Christ, and AD is after the birth of Christ. But now we don't use these terms anymore. We speak in terms of BCE and CE, before Common Era and Common Era. So these are just the same terms, just more secular, okay? So I will be using the terms BCE and CE, and that is what the NCERTs use. And in case you have to write an answer in history, I urge you to use these terms because this is what we use now, before Common Era and Common Era. That's all, and I hope you enjoy the course to come. Hi guys, today we'll be talking a little bit about prehistoric South Asia, what prehistory is, and a little bit of introduction to the Harappan civilization. There's a little bit about me. I'm Nandini and I've done my undergrad in history. So prehistory and history, the difference is between written and non-written sources. For prehistory, we don't have written records. For history, we do have written records. But for a little bit, for gray areas like the Harappan civilization, for which we do have written sources, but they're not deciphered, we use the term proto-history. The first part about human history are the Stone Ages, which is when we started using stone tools and stone technology. These are the Paleolithic, Mesolithic and Neolithic ages, and they're based on, say, divisions of geological age, type and style of tool technology, etc. But don't get too involved in this, just concentrate a little bit on the timeline. So the three stone ages, which are both Lithic, which derives from the word stone, are Paleolithic, Mesolithic and Neolithic. Then there was the Chalcolithic age, which defined the first use of copper. And the Harappan civilization was from this age, which means it was before the Iron Age. Remember that Harappan is Chalcolithic. No iron was found during Harappan civilization. And then finally, we have written sources from, say, 600 BCE. Now the three stone ages. Paleolithic is the oldest and the longest stone age, from 2 million years ago, MYI is million years ago, to 12,000 years ago, and a site in India is Hunksi. And interestingly, there were ostriches found in India at that time, and people even made craft material out of ostrich eggs. And then there was the Mesolithic age, which was 12,000 to 10,000 years ago. And importantly for India, art Mesolithic art was found, and in Bhimbetka, this is one of the oldest arts found in the world. So you can really go and Google pictures of Bhimbetka and see the amazing art that there is from there. And small tools were found there, microliths. Micro means small, lith means tools. That means Paleolithic had big stone tools. Neolithic is the most recent stone age, and it started from about 10,000 years ago and continued in different times in different parts of the world. And it Neolithic age is when agriculture, domestication, etc. began. And these are some of the sites of India, which you can see if you are interested. Now, the people in prehistoric South Asia were mostly hunter-gatherers. And there is an example of a settlement near Narmada. Agriculture is found very rarely, and importantly, we have rice grown in Vindhyas 8,000 years ago. This is one of the earliest cultivations of rice, and there are some more Neolithic age sites. So the sources, how we identify these sites, is either the people lived there or they made tools over there. So that is factory and habitation sites, but that's not really important for us to remember from the civil services exam point of view, unless you're taking history as an optional. And these sites were really close to water bodies, and perhaps fire was also used, as is evidence from the Kurnool caves. Now, the Harappan civilization is called Harappan because Harappa was the first discovered site. This is a general trend of naming civilization across the world. And from 2600 to 1900 BCE was the mature Harappan phase, which is when the civilization was in full swing. And before and after were the early phase, when the civilization was developing, and the later phase when the civilization was dying down. And it was from Afghanistan to Gujarat. Here we can see the spread. So it covers nearly all of Pakistan, large parts of India, and of Afghanistan as well. So, the discovery of Harappa was announced in 1924 by John Marshall, the Director General of Archaeological Survey of India. And he found that Harappa is contemporaneous with the Mesopotamia, which was really exciting news, because till then we didn't know that there was any civilization as old as Mesopotamia. And before John Marshall, Alexander Cunningham, who was the first Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, he had come across many Harappan artifacts, but he only sort of understood Indian history to begin from the time of Mahajanpadas and Rigved, not before that. So he just sort of discarded those artifacts, could not fit them in the then known time frame of South Asia, and was not able to see the amazing bits of history that were right in front of him. But thankfully for us, John Marshall came across and announced Harappa. We'll talk a little bit more about the Harappan civilization in the next episode of presentation. So please do watch it. Thank you. Hi guys, today we are going to continue with studying the Harappan civilization, and please watch this video after you have seen the previous video, because it's in continuation. This is a little bit about me. I'm Nandini, and I have done my graduation in history. So, what did the Harappans eat? This may not sound that interesting, but we have to do it for some specific, because some specific questions are asked in UPSC from this. So, okay, they ate plants, animal and fish. This is not that important, but how they grew their food. Irrigation arrangements. So there were canals at Shortugai, Afghanistan, and there was a plowed field at Kalibangan. They do ask these things and match the following. Okay, as we go on more and more, you'll understand what I mean. And there was a water reservoir at Dholavira. Remember these things, try to make mnemonics and remember where and which kind of arrangement was there, right? And cotton was cultivated in Mehrgarh. Okay, so they have asked, was there cotton during the Harappan ages? Was there rice? Was there, you know, things like that. So be very clear about these small details. They are very annoying to remember, but they are important. Okay, so let's move on to the city plan, and we'll talk about Mohenjo-daro, which is the biggest site and it's an urban site. So almost all Harappan cities had two sections, a citadel and a lower town. Now the citadel was usually on the west, and it was fortified and separated from the lower town. And the lower town was on a lower side east, not east, okay? And it was low and large, and it was also walled. We don't really know what the citadel was used for. Lower town was a residential area, of course. But there was a great bath at the Mohenjo-daro citadel, and perhaps it had some ritual significance. Many a times we've also found warehouses. Okay, now these planned settlements had a bricks of standardized ratio. So that really, really suggests that labor was mobilized on a huge scale. And there were streets on top of drains, there were houses built alongside. You can go through this slide more thoroughly. And now these variations are important. Dholavira, which is a site in India. So please make sure that you are very aware of the new developments and the new findings about the sites in India, because they are more relevant to us, right? To Indians. So the Dholavira site was in three parts, and also it had large writing. Most of the writing that we found is small and scribbled on seals. So Dholavira has two things that you need to remember: three parts instead of the usual two of the citadel and the lower town, and large writing. Now Lothal, which is also in India, Run of Kutch and Gulf of Kambath are where these respectively are. Lothal has a dockyard, so it was an important trading center, and it was also a center where a lot of production was happening, metal and shell craft. Okay, so it was just an overall important site from the view of commerce, and the citadel was not walled. Now many craft and trade centers are also there, which is Chanudaru was an important craft center, which is now in Pakistan. Nageshwar and Balakot are coastal towns famous for shell work. And lapis lazuli was obtained from Afghanistan, Shortugai. So just go through all these and try to remember them, make some mnemonics, because I've just given you this information because all this stuff is often asked in prelims. You can go through the previous year questions and see. Okay, you can also make some arrangements with the modern times. For example, copper from the Khetri region, we still have mines there, right? So these mines have been in use for like thousands and thousands of years. And gold from South India, we still get it, right? Try to make as many connections as you can and remember this. Archaeologists often study burials to understand the social differences that were there. Do some graves have more artifacts and jewelry, etc., buried with them, whereas some other graves might be bare, right? But overall, they found out that Harappans did not believe in burying precious things with the dead. So we are not able to derive much information about social differences. And even from the artifacts, we can study about luxurious and utilitarian items. But we find that luxurious items are found in large settlements like Harappa and Mohenjo-daro. And one important luxurious item peculiar to the Harappan civilization is faience, which is, you can read exactly how it's made. And they used to make like delicate, beautiful pots out of it, bits and pieces of which have still survived. And of course, there was gold found. This slide will be more useful for someone who is writing, say, optional in history, not so much for general, but because it is given in the NCERT, I have included it here. Now, for seal script and religion, you can pay attention to this. Like I've already said, that there was ritual significance of the great bath at Mohenjo-daro and fire altars at Lothal and Kalibangan. But the seals... The script is undeciphered till now. Seals were used for trade and for identifying senders, etc. Religion, we don't know anything about. So these are some of the things that tell us about the religion, but we are not really sure. For example, there's a proto Shiva. There's a sculpture with a cross-legged yogic figure on it, which, yeah, this is it. This is called the proto Shiva, but we haven't traced the connections between this figure and then what is what we now call Shiva. Exactly. So it's just called proto Shiva as a convenience. And now this is the dancing girl. She's a bronze sculpture and she was made with the lost wax technique. You can read about this technique a little bit more. And these are some of the seals and with the sculptures and impressions on them. And this is the writing that we have no clue what it says at all. And these are the kind of animals that were depicted. So it's to be understood that these animals were found over there. Right, elephants and bulls, etc. And this is the priest king. This is again just a sculpture that we have named the priest king because we really, really don't know what was the political organization over there. What is the state structure? This is the only symbol that we have that maybe there was a theocracy. Maybe there was no state. We really don't know. So there are just a lot of theories. And one of them says that this sculpture is a symbol of the priest king. Okay, so we don't have any confirmed theories about how the state was organized, but the standardization of scripts, ways, bricks, settlements, etc., suggests that there was some kind of centralized authority. But there are no depictions of power in the means of palaces or anything like that. And there are three theories: no rulers, single ruler, several rulers. Okay, but we don't really know. And as far as the theories of decline go, if you are taking history up as your optional, please, please, after you finish this slide, go and write an answer on this. This is one of the very important questions that they ask about ancient Indian history. And there are many theories like climatic change, Aryan invasion. This is one of the most controversial theories, okay? And deforestation, shifting up and drying up of rivers, overuse of landscape, collapse of the state. None of these theories are confirmed, but archaeologists and historians hope that once the script is deciphered, we will know more. As of now, I greatly urge you to keep up with the news and find out any new discoveries or ideas that are found about the Harappan civilization, because it might seem static, but it is history is also a growing subject. Thank you. Hi guys, what's up? And today we're going to be studying all about Vedic literature. What are the Vedas? What are the epics, Purans, Dharma Shastras? What are the additions to it and why is it important to study Vedic literature, right? So this is just a little bit about me. I am a graduate in history and I also have a master's in human rights and I love to dance, read and teach. So why do you need to know about Vedic literature? First of all, it is the source of all Hindu social structure, all the caste system, the ashram system, position of women. Everything is there in the Vedic literature, what ancient Hindu society was like, okay? And it's also the source of ancient Indian past, because obviously it's based in the Himalayan region, began from there, spread on, and covers a lot of the Indian subcontinent. And for more practically, it has continuous references throughout the NCERTs without a consolidated discussion anywhere. So you'll be reading random things like Upanishad mein ye likha hai, or this is what the Dharma Shastra says, but you won't really know what Upanishads or Dharma Shastras are. So this presentation will explain all that. And sometimes, very very rarely, questions are asked in pre. For example, take this one, it's a really simple question. More complicated ones are asked, but I suggest that you do not spend too much time learning and reading about the ways. Just this one 10 minute presentation should be enough. And so which one of the following Vedas contains account of magical charms and spells? These are your options, and you can write in the comments at the end of the slide what the answer is. So we need to understand what Shruti and Smriti is. Okay, so Shruti is what Vedas are called that which is heard or revealed from gods, and it's not unlike Quran and Bible, which were revealed at one point of time to one particular individual or messenger of God. The Vedas were revealed, so as to say, over a long period of time to different Rishi Munis across, and they contain sort of an universal truth. And then what people interpreted and understood from the Vedas, or what is remembered from the Vedas, is called Smriti. And that is the rest of the literature which we will be talking about. So there are four types of Vedas, and Ved comes from a root which means to know. So the four types of Veda are Rig, which is the oldest, and this is the most important Ved, and we will soon see why. And of course, it's the oldest, and it has a lot of hymns called Suktas, and it has 10 books, and every book is called a Mandal. Then there is the Sam, which has hymns borrowed from the Ved, arranged differently according to musical notation. And there's Yajur, which has the performance of ritual, which is very important for understanding the history of how kings tried to establish their importance and their superiority by performing so and so ritual written in Yajur Ved, ki humne is Ved se ritual kiya hai. And then there's the Athar Ved, which is the latest, and it contains hymns, charms and spells. So I'm sure you already know the answer to your previous question. So there are four parts in each Ved. One is the Samhita, which is the main part, and that has the hymns. Then there is the Brahmana, which is the explanation of Samhita. There's Aranyaka, which has philosophical interpretations of rituals and different things, all interpretations and stuff, like thoda aur samjha diya. Then Upanishads, which are important because they are mentioned separately in NCERT, these are philosophical writings, and the main idea conveyed through them is the idea of Atma, that is individual soul, and Brahma, which is universal soul, and ultimately both are one. So one important thing to understand is that the Vedic literature is divided by historians, not by, you know, how they were, not naturally. It's an artificial classification made by historians that the old Vedic literature written from 1500 to 1000 BC is called the Rig Ved. It is the Rig Ved Samhita, and that too book 2 to 7 only. And these are the pre-classical Sanskrit. That is, by this time Sanskrit grammar was not codified. And the later Vedic literature is written in codified Sanskrit. And Sanskrit was codified by this man called Panini in his book Ashtadhyayi, written from the later Vedic literature is from 1000 to 500 BCE. Then there's the Vedangna literature, which are just supplementary texts to the Vedas used for recitation, understanding of the Vedas, etc., written from 600 to 200 BCE. And then then there are the Puranas, which literally mean Purana, old, and they're traditionally attributed to Vyas. Now, what does traditionally attributed mean? We'll see very, very soon. And there are 18 Mahapurans and lots of Upurans, hundreds. And they're written from 5th century CE, from Vedic age till 5th century CE. And they have mythical history and some historical history also about dynasties and stuff. And they have the conception of time about Yug, and lots of other classifications of time. So, Kalyug ki baat kahan likhi hai? Time ki baat Puran mein likhi hai. Then there are the epics, and I'm sure you already know a lot about them. And they are both some explanations of the Vedas or ideal society as it was supposed to be then, and Itihas, that is traditional history. And Mahabharat is also written by Vyas, like Puranas. And Mahabharat is written from 400 BCE to 400 CE. Now, Vyas was one mortal man. He could not have lived for 800 years, right? That's why we say it's been attributed traditionally to Vyas. But he was one man. He wrote major parts of the Mahabharat, and then changes were made upon it as the centuries passed, right? And it contains the Bhagavad Gita, which is a discourse of Krishna to Arjun, and it has a lot of philosophical basis of what Hindu philosophy. I'm using Hindu as a very loose term, right? I'm sure you know the current sociological interpretation of how we use Hindu, not in the way some political parties and some cultural parties use it. So there are strong women characters in Mahabharat, And since this was written before Ramayana, it suggests that women were freer at the time of Mahabharata, that is earlier, in the earlier Vedic ages, as compared to Ramayana. So position of women deteriorated as time passed. If they ask you in a sociology answer, you can cite this. Now, in Dharma, I'm sorry about this. So the epics, Ramayana is written by Valmiki from 500 BC to 300 BC, and it's the story of Ram and the many retellings. You might want to look at this. Most importantly, Ramcharitmanas by Tulsidas, which is 16th century, but there are others in different languages. So you might want to go through this slide. Now, the Dharma Shastras are another auxiliary to the Vedas, and they are in three parts, which first one of which is the Dharma Sutras. And of the Dharma Sutras, the first part is the one which discusses complex Vedic sacrifices with at least three fires. And the second part of the Dharma Shastras are the Dharma Sutras that discuss simple domestic sacrifices. Get it? So Dharma Shastras, Dharma Sutras with complex Vedic sacrifices, Dharma Sutras with simple Vedic sacrifices. These are two parts, and the third part are the Smritis, which are commentaries and conclusions from different texts. And this is written from 200 BC to 900 CE. You know Manusmriti? Yes, that is a part of... Yes, so Manusmriti is a part of the Dharma Shastras. Lastly, the Dharma Shastra, more about the Dharma Shastra, this is where the caste system is talked about, okay? This is really important. This is the source of the caste system. Please keep this in mind. And the ashram system. I'm sure you've heard about the ashram system as well. It divides ideal life for dwij-born men into four parts. Dwij-born, the upper three castes, and men, only men. So, brahmacharya, when you're supposed to concentrate on studies, not concentrate on women, etc. Grihastha, when you're supposed to get married, have children. Vanprastha, when you're supposed to start retrieving from married and worldly life. And sannyas, when you're supposed to retreat completely from married and worldly life. And they also describe other things about society like law and how ideal society should be, etc. So this is the entire Vedic corpus, and we have just discussed the different parts and the different aspects of it and how Hindu society is derived from the Ved and the Vedic corpus. Thank you so much for listening. I hope this is helpful to you. Hi guys, in this lesson we'll be talking about the early states from 600 BCE to 600 CE of ancient India. And this is a little bit about me. I'm Nandini and I've done my graduation in history. So between the IVC and early states, there were agro-pastoral communities, not so many states as such, okay? So there were no empires or kingdoms. And it was the Iron Age, and this was the time when Rig Veda was composed by people who called themselves Aryas, and the people who didn't perform those sacrifices or, you know, conform to the Rig Veda were called Dasas or Dasyus. Okay, and this is the time of the painted greyware. Do keep this in mind, because they do ask a little bit about relevant time frames of the relevant potteries. We'll do a little bit more as we go along. Okay, and the important gods of this time were Agni, Indra, and Som. Also, this is the time when megaliths were there. Mega means big, lith again means stone, literally big stone boulders. And these were the stone structures that covered burials. And important site in India is Inamgaon. And this is important because burials tell us a lot about society and cultural practices and religious practices. And we found that a lot of these burials contained iron tools, black and red ware, pottery, and, you know, moving on from painted grey ware. So around 600 BC, states started emerging and use of iron became prominent. There was a technological improvement and paddy transplantation started, coinage started, cities started, diverse thoughts like Buddhism, Jainism, etc. started. And the states were the 16 Mahajanpadas, which literally means land where people settled, and they were ruled by kings or oligarchies, and they maintained armies and they fortified their capital cities, and sometimes they even collected taxes. So this is the emergence of early states. And these states, the capitals of these states were important trading religious centers, And Puhar was an important seaport. Ujjain was a land route. These are just examples. And from 600 BCE, northern black polish ware started. Okay, and it had this shiny finish and was probably, you know, expensive. And there was a lot of overland trade and overseas trade to Roman Empire, Central Asia, etc. So this is a good happening economic, political time. Many changes were happening. This is just a map, and you don't need to remember the names of all of these Mahajanpatas. But keep in mind, Magad, we'll be talking about that, which is centered around Bihar, West Bengal, Jharkhand, etc., that area. So the Magadhan Empire, it was really placed, geographically placed very well, okay? There were forests nearby, there were iron mines, which we still use today, right? Jharkhand, and there were the rivers, and the capital was Rajgir and Pataliputra, okay, both of them. And so the first dynasty there was Brihadaratha. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but they were the first to rule Magad. But the important dynasty was Haranyaka dynasty, which is where Bimbisara was a very important ruler, and he was a follower of Mahavira and Buddha, and he met both, and so did his son Ajatashatru. Then there was the Shaishung dynasty and Nanda dynasty. Remember that this is the dynasty which was in power when Alexander came. And then there was the Mauryan dynasty, which is most important. And then there was the Shung dynasty and Gupta dynasty. So just remember the names of Mauryan and Gupta, and they ruled Magad. So Mauryan dynasty was founded by Chandragupta Maurya and succeeded by Bimbisara, his son, and then his son Ashok. And Megasthenes wrote the Indica and about Chandragupta Maurya. This book is kind of lost now, so we only have bits and pieces and references. But this is an important source of the Mauryan dynasty. They can ask you sources. So keep Megasthenes' Indica and Kautilya's Arthashastra in mind. Okay. And the other sources were Buddhist, Jain, Sanskrit, Prakritic literature, etc., some archaeological sources as well. And the Magadhan dynasty was so huge that they had 5 capitals, okay? And these were all like located at important areas. So do keep these capital names in mind, okay? Now, Ashok was the most important ruler, and it is very, very important for us because we have so many things that are still relevant today. Like the Ashok Chakra is on our national flag, the lion capital is our emblem, and he inspired the 19th century nationalists, right? So he was a powerful, massive empire, okay? And what is really important about him is that he embraced Buddhism after the Kalinga War. So he won the war and he stopped expanding it. Kalinga is modern Orissa. And he inscribed messages to people on stone surfaces. उन्होंने अपने प्रजा को जानने और पहचानने और उनसे बात करने की कोशिश करी. He propagated Dhamma, the right way of life. So he was a very pious leader and a very, very non-violent, well, later non-violent, of course, you know, after he had massively expanded his empire. And he had simple ideas which focused on tolerance and respect and kindness. So he is a model king, and he really inspired our nationalists, and he still inspires our nation. So do study a little bit about him. And so you can see how absolutely huge the empire is. And I don't know how they managed it without modern means of transport and communication, but oh well. And then there were the Kushans after the Mauryas. Now we are no longer talking about the Magadhan area, we are talking about northwestern India, okay? And this is the 1st century to BCE to 1st century CE. And they were preceded by Indo-Greeks and Shakas, and Kushans were also Central Asian, right? Mathura was an important center at their time. It was their second capital. First capital was Peshawar. And they controlled the Silk Route, and there are huge statues of Kushan kings near Mathura. And the kings claimed divine status. Why did they claim divine status? Because they were not Kshatriyas. So traditionally, they were not allowed to rule. So they said, okay, we are the son of gods. We are Dev Putras. So you can allow us to rule. We have that authority. Okay. And they issued the first gold coins in India. Keep this part in mind. These trivias, you know, they ask in prelim sometimes, right? And Kanishk was the most important ruler, and he organized a Buddhist council. This is really important. He organized a conglomeration of all the Buddhist thinkers. And again, so source was his court poet Ashwaghosh, who composed Buddha Charitra. And he lived in Kanishka's court. So this is an important source. And connected with coinage, Yodhyas of Punjab and Haryana, who were a tribal republic, also issued coins around the same time. Okay. And this is the Kushan Empire. And see, it extends up to Afghanistan, and there's Mathura, and it covers quite a lot of the Indian, modern Indian nation as we know it. So thank you. Next presentation, we'll be talking a little bit more about other states. Thank you so much. Hi guys, we're going to be continuing with the early states and societies. And the first, this is a little bit about me. I'm Nandini, and I've done my graduation in history. And the first kingdoms that we'll be talking about are the Cheras, Cholas, and Pandyas. So these are all rulers of Tamilakam, that is mostly southern India, that is today Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Kerala, Tamil Nadu. And you'll see that all of these empires lasted for almost 1,000 years. Okay, so these are like long-ranging kingdoms. And the three chiefs of each of these are called Muvendr. Okay, I'm not very sure about the pronunciation. And the major source that we have for them is Sangam literature. And do remember these three, four things, because sometimes they are short notes about Sangam literature. These were codified and properly written at three literary meetings at Madurai, which was the Pandya inland capital. And the epics, like the Sanskrit epics, are Mahabharata and Ramayana. There's Mani Mekalai and Sila Paddikatam. Okay, I'm not very sure about the pronunciation again. And each of these kingdoms had two centers, and you don't have to remember each and every one of them, but just remember that the Pandya capital was Madurai. They had one inland and one coastal capital. So Madurai was the Indian capital, inland capital, and the Cholas had Puhar as a coastal capital. Now this is important because it was a very, very important trading center, especially for trade with Rome. Okay, now we'll talk about the Satavahanas. So from southern India, we've moved up to western and central India, that's around Deccan. Okay, and they were there from 2nd century BCE to 2nd century CE. And they don't have very clear social origins. So we don't know if they were Brahmins or Kshatriyas or anything like that. But one of their leaders claimed to be a Brahmin. That was Gautami Putta Sri Satkani. We also know that they get their names from their mothers, okay, through metronymics. So Gautami Putta Sri Satkani's mother was Gautami Bala Sri. So you can see the connection, Gautami Putta. Right, but overall the society was patriarchal, right? And they also issued coins stamped with images of their rulers, and they fought many battles with the Shakas of Central Asia. Okay, and something important about a Shaka ruler Rudradaman is that he constructed Sudarshan Lake, and that was an artificial reservoir at Girnar. So irrigation and technology development of that time, what is we need to know about those things for ancient technological movements and art, culture, etc. That's not really art culture, but just how our society is moving towards what we see today. Okay, just a little map. So these are the Cholas, Pandya's kingdoms. Cheras are somewhere over here. Okay, so not really there in the map. And this is the Satavahana Empire. Now we'll talk about the Gupta kingdom, and this was a vast kingdom, and it's considered the golden age by some historians, although other historians heavily dispute that theory. But because there was a lot of development of art, culture, science, technology, etc., right? Kalidas was a court poet at that time, and Aryabhatta was in there Kingdom and Fazian visited Gupta Empire during this rule. So exactly whose rule you have to know, which is Chandragupta II. Okay, let's talk a little more systematically about the Gupta Empire. The first important ruler was Chandragupta Maurya, and he called himself Maharajadhiraj. Then he ruled over Magad, Prayag, which is the old name for Allahabad. And after Chandragupta, there was Samudragupta, about whom is the Allahabad pillar inscription. This is very important. Pragya Prashasti, which was composed by his court poet Harish Sena. Do remember this, okay? These 2 points. And he performed the Ashwamedh sacrifice, expanded his kingdom. Then he was followed by Chandragupta II, who was called Vikramaditya. And he overcame last of the Shakas. And the iron pillar near Qutub Minar is another source for Chandragupta II. And his daughter Prabhavati Gupta was married to a king of the Vakataka kingdom, and she ruled Vakataka kingdom when her husband passed away and her very small son was put on the throne. So this is really important, one of our ancient queens. So do keep this in mind. She also made land grants, etc. Okay. And finally, the Gupta Empire declined slowly, and the Huns occupied the main parts of the Gupta Empire, and the rest got scattered into different areas, and they issued gold coins. Okay, so again, it suggests a rich, healthy economy. And their decline is also might be related to the decline of the Western Roman Empire. Okay, so they were having very good trade relations with them, and with the decline of Rome, we also see a decline in India's wealth. So keep that in mind, these connections. So Aryabhatta wrote Aryabhattam, and I think I've already spoken about this. So this is kind of a map of Chandragupta's conquests, and they also started from Pataliputra. The Magadha was their center, and then they expanded all over central and northwestern India. Next is Harshvardhana. He's also a post-Gupta king. You don't have to remember too much about him, but remember the source. Okay, Huanzang was another Chinese writer who spent time who was here in Harshvardhan's time, and he spent time in his court, and he spent time at Nalanda. And another was Banbhatta, who was his court poet, who wrote Harshcharitra. Okay, then Pallavs and Chalukyas, they controlled the Deccan areas, and see, their capital is at Kanchipuram and mostly over the Kaveri Delta, and they were defeated by the Cholas. And the Chalukyas are there who ruled between Raichur Daw between Tungabhadra and Krishna. And these two capitals of kingdoms often raided each other, and the best known Chalukya king is Pulakeshin II, who also had a Prashasti dedicated to him by his court poet Ravi Kirti. Now, the script that we have all these sources and all these poems and writings and inscriptions in is Brahmi, and which is used in Ashokan inscriptions, and Kharosthi. This is more of Northwestern, used by Indo-Greeks, okay? And these were deciphered by James Prinsep. And the languages that they used was Prakrit. Okay. Of course, a lot of the work was also written in Sanskrit, but we've already spoken about the Sanskrit works. Now, social organization is really, really important, even from the point of view of your means for any sociology answers. This will be useful information. So, obviously, the society was organized in. It was a patriarchal and patrilineal society, and exogamy, that is marriage outside of your caste, etc., was desirable. Gotra system, which was a dominating system, which calculates your lineage from a Vedic seer. And there was a caste and jati system. Caste are the four broad varnas that are there, and jati then are the following occupations that developed within castes, right? And these occupations sometimes also organize themselves into guilds and shrenis. And outside of the four varns, then there were untouchables, example chandals. Then there were the nishads, which were forest dwellers, and mechas were like people from outside. So if the Indo-Greeks come and start ruling us, we don't know who they are. So they were called mlechs. And Buddhism, Jainism contested these norms, and much later during the medieval period, there were the Bhakti Sufi movements which again contested all these social norms. And our sources are Mahabharata, Dharma Shastra, Dharma Sutra, Manusmriti, etc. We've spoken about this. And a very good edition of Mahabharata is the critical edition by V.S. Sukthankar. And he went all over India collecting all the different tellings of Mahabharata and how it is told. And all of it is compiled into one 13,000 page book. So I don't suggest you read it, but this is the most consolidated edition of Mahabharata that we have. And lastly, only if you are writing the optional, you could go through all these terms. I don't think that they are very important. Perhaps Gahapati, who is the agricultural laborer or small peasant, basically the head of the house. Okay, so that might come a little bit in use. But do keep Samanta in mind, which is like feudal lord. So obviously these people had huge empires and they can't rule all on their own, right? Hi guys. Please, please, please concentrate on this video. It is very important for the point of ancient Indian history and art and culture, okay? We are going to be talking about Buddhism and Jainism. So, a little bit about me. I'm Nandini and I have done my undergraduate in history. And just to start off, so the first millennium BCE saw many, many philosophers like Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Kongzi, all these are Greek, Kongzi from China, Zarathustra, Mahavira and Buddha, these are of course our own Indian philosopher. Zoroastrianism also started around this time, and Zoroaster was an Italian prophet and his teachings are compiled in Avesta, and his followers, the Zoroastrian, are the ancestors of today's Parsis, and he gave the maxim good thoughts, good words and good deeds, which is just a really nice idea. Even if you don't follow Zoroastrianism on its own, you can follow this idea. There were many philosophers in South India, and the new trends that came around basically questioned the authority of the Vedas and Brahmanism and emphasized individual agency. That's why they were so attractive to many lower classes and lower castes, because they found more space to be themselves in these new philosophies and religions. And in India, Kutagra Shala were the huts where intellectuals debates took place. Just a term, okay? Now, some women and poor thinkers whose ideas are mentioned in the Upanishads. So, because these are some exceptions to the general rule of Brahmins writing them, I have mentioned them. Gargi was a woman who participated in debates at courts. And Satyakamala Jabala was a son of a slave woman, right? And let's begin with Jainism. So Mahavir was, his time frame is sometime around the early 6th century BCE, and he was born Vardhaman, his name, and he was a Kshatriya prince of the Lichhavis of the Vajji Sangh, which if you remember is one of the Mahajanpadas. And he lived in a forest for 12 years and attained enlightenment, and he was the last of the 24 Tirthankaras, okay? Tirthankaras are the Jain thinkers and teachers who literally guide men and women across the river of existence, and their followers are Jains and are known as Jains, and their philosophy is that the entire world is animated. They believe in non-violence, reincarnation and karma, and they believe that to be free of reincarnation and karma, asceticism and renunciation of the world is necessary. And Mahavir also gave the principle of Anekantvad, which is the plurality of viewpoints in Nyayavad and Satyavad, essentially non-absolutism, okay? This is one of the important philosophies of Jainism. And the Jain monks and nuns took 5 vows to abstain from killing, stealing, lying, and to observe celibacy and to abstain from possessing property. The men did not even possess clothes in the earlier forms, okay? And the literature is in Prakrit, Tamil, and the chief disciple, Gautam Swami, Mahavir's chief disciple, compiled his teachings in Jain Agamas. And there are some more sources mentioned here. And all of these are available at Valabhi, Gujarat. Okay, so this is where Mahavir's teachings are available. And Jainism was mostly supported by traders, because farmers who had to kill for a living, you know, pesticides, etc., that we use today, and earlier also, they had some method of pest management. So they found it difficult to follow Jainism. And later, Jainism split into two groups, Digambaras in the south, who didn't wear clothes, and Shvetambaras in the north, who wore white clothes. And one of Mahavir's disciples started the Ajivika sect, right? Which said that everything is predetermined, so do whatever you want to, right? And then there was Buddha, who's also 6th to 4th century BCE. We don't exactly know his date. And he's a Kshatriya from the Saka Gan. And please remember every single thing that is in bold in this slide, okay? He was born at Lumbini. He attained enlightenment at Bodh Gaya. He taught first at Sarnath, and he passed away at Kusinara. Pause the slide and read it 10 times at least, and remember everything given in this. Now, Buddhist literature. Now, Buddha taught orally, and then his teachings were slowly compiled, okay? And at Vaishali, which is in the 4th, 5th BC, they were compiled into the Tipitaka. Now, Vinaya Pitaka has the rules and regulations for the monastic orders. Sutta Pitaka are Buddha's teachings, and Abhidhamma Pitaka are the study and systematization of the Sutta Pitaka. And even from Sri Lanka, we have Deepvamsa and Mahavamsa, which are sources of Buddhist literature, and there are many, many more, but this is just a very brief overview. Now, Buddha's teaching, again, please pause this and write it. So if you ever have to write a short note on Buddha's or Buddhist teaching, you can follow this, right? Go slowly, take your time through this slide. Just remember that he taught in Prakrit so that it would be accessible to more and more people, okay? Because Prakrit was the language of the people instead of Sanskrit, right? And in the early forms, God was irrelevant, existence of God. And this is Theravada Buddhism. And later, when the concept of a savior came about, that sect of Buddhism is called Mahayana Buddhism, which means large vehicle, greater vehicle, and they call the older form Hinayana Buddhism, which is smaller Buddhism, okay? And Bodhisattva become important at this point of time. Now, Buddha's followers lived in a Sangha, which is the monastic order, and they lived simply on alms, and they're called bhikkhus and bhikkhunis, okay? And theras and theris are the respected men and women who had attained liberation and taught. And I remember that initially only men were allowed, but a disciple of Buddha called Anand convinced Buddha to allow women also into the monastic order, and Mahajapati Gautami was the first bhikkhuni. Now, stupas are the places associated with Buddha's life, and they have relics of Buddha in the central mound, which has the relic casket. And Ashok started this culture of erecting stupas, and he started with a pillar at Lumbini to mark Buddha's birthplace. Lots of people contributed to it, and I've mentioned some of the important stupas that were there. And the most important standing stupa that we have is at Sachi, and it was discovered by Alexander Cunningham, and it is preserved in site. And this is the architectural structure of a stupa. So this is really important from art and culture point of view. These are the four structures. So there was the basic mound, and then there was the anda, and then there was the harmika, which is the balcony-like structure above the anda. There's the yashti, which is a mast rising from the harmika, and there's the chhatri, which is an umbrella surmounting the yashti. And there's just an image from one of the sculptures at Sachi, and it's Shalabhanjika. So she's an auspicious woman who causes trees to bear fruits and flowers. And this is not necessarily a Buddhist symbol. So you keep in mind that other people who joined Buddhism brought their cultures with them, okay? And there are some other, discussion of what the sculptures at Sachi were like. I'm sure you know already about Shaivism and Jainism, the cult of Vishnu and the cult of Shiv, and they talk about the 10 avatars of Vishnu, and they worship the Ling. And last bit about temple architecture of that time, which temples basically had a garbhagriha, which was the doorway into the deity's image, and initial temples were like this. Then they started developing more. So there was the shikhar, which was the tall structure over the shrine. There was the mandap, which is the hall of assemblies. And keep these three temple names in mind: Kailashnath, Mahabalipuram, and Ehore, because they are all carved from one stone. That means they are monolithic. So again, I urge you to pay more and most attention to this presentation amongst this course, because it's very important from art and culture point of view also, and from ancient history point of view also. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed the course.